We're going to be in Joshua chapter 4, and we're processing through this amazing book. You may or may not know this. I'm named after Joshua, and I know that that's awkward, or maybe not awkward, but maybe you didn't know that. I'm named after Joshua. I love the book. I love his story, and how God used him, and just that transition as he was learning from Abraham and this beloved leader of God's people, and then he's got to fill in those shoes, and God transitions him into leadership over the nation of Israel. And we see in chapter 1 where that occurs, as God says, "You're my man, don't be afraid, I've got this, I've got your back, I'm going to lead you, I'm going to guide you, I'm going to give you everything that you need." And he confirms that, and then he confirms the promise that he had given to this nation over and over and over again, that I will lead you into the land that I've promised you. And then when you go into chapter 2, which we looked at last week, you see Joshua sends spies across the river into the city of Jericho, and they're just checking things out a little bit, kind of seeing what the lay of the land is, what the attitude and the perspective of the people in Jericho are. They come in contact with a prostitute whose name is Rahab, not Rehab, right? We talked about that last week. Whose name is Rahab, and Sherman brought this amazing message and this truth that if God can use Rahab, who can he not use, right? And he can use all of us. And so she's a part of the story. She's brought into the lineage of Jesus, and just this amazing truth that God can and does use all people, those who are willing to be used. And then the week before, we've done a little back and forth. We're in chapter 3, which is then the crossing of the nation of Israel through the Jordan on wet ground. Dry ground, right? Completely dry ground. 2 million plus people cross the Jordan. And we talked about how God gave them instruction that before they are to move anywhere, they were to follow what? Remember? The ark, which was symbolic of God's presence. That's where God's presence resided with his people. And God said, follow the ark, because you don't know where you're going. Basically saying, I know the way, I'll lead you. Your responsibility is just to go where I'm leading. And he told the priest, just put your feet in the water, just take a step into the water, and once you do, I'll handle the rest. And we see that they were obedient to that. The priest carrying the ark stepped into the Jordan, which was overflowing its banks at that time of the year, and the flow of water was cut off. The ground miraculously was instantly dry, because it would have been a hot mess to get 2 million people across muddy ground. He dried it out, and then the people crossed over to the other side. And we learn that God leads us where he wants us to be. We need to be willing and obedient even into the unknown. And then God does miraculous things when we're obedient. So now we move into chapter 4, and it's the other side of the Jordan. We've left the priests for 2 weeks standing in the middle of the Jordan. We're going to get them out of there this morning, and we're going to see simply what God instructs them to do on the other side of the Jordan. Let's read. We're going to read all the way through chapter 4 in its entirety, and then we're going to focus in on a few of the last verses in that chapter, and we're going to see what God calls them to do and why he called them to do what it is he calls them to do. So read with me. We're going to read a lot this whole chapter. Just follow along, and let's let God's word speak to us this morning. Joshua 4, beginning in verse 1. When all the nation had finished passing over the Jordan, the Lord said to Joshua, take 12 men from the people, from each tribe a man, and command them, saying, take 12 stones from here out of the midst of the Jordan, from the very place where the priest's feet stood firmly, and bring them over with you, and lay them down in the place where you lodge tonight. Then Joshua called the 12 men from the people of Israel, whom he had appointed, a man from each tribe. And Joshua then translated or passed on what God had said. Joshua said to them, pass on before the ark of the Lord your God into the midst of the Jordan. So kind of get back in where you just crossed over. Back in, and take up each of you a stone upon his shoulder according to the number of the tribes of the people of Israel, that this may be a sign among you when your children ask in a time to come, what do these stones mean to you? Then you shall tell them that the waters of the Jordan were cut off before the ark of the covenant of the Lord. When it passed over the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan were cut off So these stones shall be to the people of Israel a what? Memorial for how long? Forever. And the people of Israel did just as Joshua commanded, took up 12 stones out of the midst of the Jordan, according to the number of the tribes of the people of Israel, just as the Lord told Joshua. And they carried them over with them to the place where they lodged and laid them down there. And Joshua then set up 12 stones in the midst of the Jordan, in the place where the feet of the priest bearing the Ark of the Covenant had stood, and they are there to this day. Okay, how many memorials are there? Two, in the Jordan and then in the encampment where they're staying. For the priest bearing the ark stood in the midst of the Jordan until everything was finished that the Lord commanded Joshua to tell the people, according to all that Moses had commanded Joshua. The people passed over in haste. I can imagine that. You know, there's faith, but then there's common sense, right? Let's get across this real quick. They passed over in haste, and when all the people had finished passing over, the ark of the Lord and the priest passed over before the people. The sons of Reuben and the sons of Gad and the half-tribe of Manasseh passed over armed before the people of Israel as Moses had told them. About 40,000 ready for war passed over before the Lord for battle to the plains of Jericho. There's a little side teaching that's great here. God leads us to where he wants us to be, in a land of promise, a land of provision. But even when we're there, there's work and there's a battle to be won. We are at this side of heaven. We are never fully removed from the attack of our enemy to cause us to stray. So they're ready, even though they're moving into provision, they're ready for war, they're ready for battle. They know it's coming. Verse 14, on that day the Lord exalted Joshua in the sight of all Israel, and they stood in awe of him just as they had stood in awe of Moses all the days of his life. That's encouraging for Joshua. And the Lord said to Joshua, command the priests bearing the ark of the testimony to come up out of the Jordan. So Joshua commanded the priests, come up out of the Jordan. And when the priest bearing the ark of the covenant of the Lord came up from the midst of the Jordan, and the soles of the priest's feet were lifted up on a dry ground, the waters of the Jordan returned to their place and overflowed all its banks as before. The people came up out of the Jordan on the 10th day of the first month, and they encamped at Gilgal on the east border of Jericho. And those 12 stones which they took out of the Jordan, Joshua set up at Gilgal. Now, let's hone in here. These next few verses are where we're really going to camp out this morning. And Joshua said to the people of Israel, when your children ask their fathers in times to come, what do these stones mean? Then you shall let your children know, Israel passed over this Jordan on dry ground. For the Lord your God dried up the waters of the Jordan for you until you passed over, as the Lord your God did to the Red Sea, which he dried up for us until we passed over that. So that all the peoples of the earth may know that the hand of the Lord is mighty, that you may fear the Lord your God forever. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the truth that's in it and the life that it grants to us. And Lord, as we read of this event that occurred thousands of years ago, we know it's historically true, it's accurate, and it's relevant for us today. God, I pray that your Holy Spirit would open our eyes and our hearts to the truth that you would have us to glean from this passage and to walk out with this morning, so that our lives might be changed for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. So there's two altars that they build that God commands. Once the people are kind of over, you get 12 stones out of the Jordan, and I want you to build an altar or a memorial in Gilgal, and then Joshua, you're going to build one in the middle of the Jordan. We have a picture here. This is actually from Gilgal, where they believe that's located. We're not sure that these are the 12 stones, right? Probably not. There were, as they have excavated this area, they found several piles of stones like this that were altars for various reasons, for the worship of God. But this, we think, is probably similar to what they would have constructed. Large stones brought and made into a pile, something that they would use to be a reminder of what God had done, this altar, this memorial to him. So they would build one on the dry ground, then they set one up in the Jordan, which is interesting because the Jordan would have then overflowed that altar. The people would not have seen it, but it's there for God, and the people would know it's there, just a memorial of what God has done. And so they build this kind of as a monument to God. And what I want us to do this morning is just kind of ask the question, why? Why did they do this? Now, we're not, we know about monuments. We know about memorials. This isn't something that they only did then that we don't do now, right? We see these all over our nation for various reasons. I always have a real fond memory of the Gateway Arch in St. Louis. We lived there when I was just a child. I'm a Cardinals fan. This year was tough for me. If you're a Cubby, I don't need to hear about that. But we lived in St. Louis. My parents would take me to the arch. I remember getting in the death can barrel elevator. You know what I'm talking about? If you've been up in the arch, they cram you in like sardines and say, good luck. Did you sign the insurance form? And then they send you up and you get to the top and then there's these windows and you get to look out over the city of St. Louis. And it's the westward expansion memorial. And what they're doing is they're reminding people that at one time the Mississippi was the furthest west we had gone. And then there was this great expansion out west. It marks that and that pioneering spirit that led men and women and families to explore out west. And so it's a memorial that tells a story. It reminds us of our history and what had occurred in the past. And there's things like that all over our country, right? We've got USS Arizona that is in Pearl Harbor. It's a reminder of the lives that were lost at that attack that began, that ushered us into World War II, and you can go and you can be reminded of people who gave their lives. It's to educate us about that event, but hopefully also it's a warning for us in the future to seek peace as we can and try to abstain from war as at all possible, because it's a brutal thing. And you go to New York City and you can see the 9/11 memorial, these two holes that are in the ground where they made the foundation and the under-earth part of the two towers and memorials and list of names there. And it's to educate us about what has happened, because we have a whole generation now growing up that weren't alive when that occurred. It's education. It's a reminder as well for us. It celebrates maybe the lives of people who were in those towers when they fell. We've got things like that all over. We're familiar with those. And so what they were doing is not anything different than what we do today, but these two altars, these two memorials had a very specific purpose for the nation of Israel as soon as they crossed the Jordan. And it communicated this altar, these 12 stones there in the encampment of Gilgal. It communicated something very specific to three different groups of people that we see here in this passage. So what I hope for us to do today is one, we can learn what was this altar about in their time, and then how does it apply to us? Because this is what we're going to see. Just as these 12 stones were a memorial, were an altar to God and what he had done, we as his children today are now living altars and living memorials to the truth of who God is. So as we examine the three things that it communicated originally, it should challenge us and motivate us to ensure that our lives are communicating in much the same way the truths about God. So let's talk about this. We notice twice it's mentioned, once in verse 6 and then again in verse 21, that God says there's a purpose, there's a reason for this altar. And the first one is this, and it's mentioned twice, is that this altar might be a teaching to the next generation, that it might communicate something to the children. I think it's interesting that God says, and he just understands that, hey, listen, you're going to build this. And because children are naturally curious, because I, as God, created them that way, they're going to come up to you at some point. They're going to say, Mom, Dad, why is this altar here? Like, why did you drag these big 12 stones out of the river and place them here? Like, we've heard that's where it comes from. Why in the world would you do that? One, I just love just the realness of God here. He knows the kids are going to ask questions, because God created our children to be curious, to be inquisitive, and to ask questions. These Israelite children really aren't all that different from our children today, right? Our children have tablets. Their children had tablets. Theirs were stone, right? Take you a minute, maybe think on that. You'll get it. But, you know, they're not all that different. Just as our children ask a lot of questions, theirs would as well. And God said, this is going to be an opportunity. This altar built here, your kids are going to come up, they're going to see it, and they're going to say, Mom, Dad, why the altar? And God says, this will be an opportunity for you to teach the next generation about who I am, about who I am and what I had done. So a conversation as instructed in Scripture would be a son or a daughter would come up, "Mom, Dad, why the stones?" Well, let me tell you, there was a time not too long ago when we were on the other side of the Jordan. This whole nation, we lived over there. It was called the wilderness. It was tough, it was hard, but God led us around. And then we came up to this body of water, and God had promised that he'd give us where we live now. But there was a problem. We had to get across the Jordan. And we're a big people with a lot of stuff. It's hard to cross a body of water like that. Plus, it was the time when the river normally overflows. And so we were expecting God to do something. And God said, "If you'll follow me and if you'll be obedient, I'll provide a way across." And you know what happened? The priests, you know those guys that wear the crazy uniforms? Yeah, we see them. Those guys, they were to carry the Ark of the Covenant. And as soon as they stepped in the water, God cut off the flow of water. And then all of us, all 2 million plus of us, we crossed over. And then the water came back, and God delivered us from the wilderness into this promised land. He's a mighty God. He has control over all creation. He's able to stop the flow of the water that he started at the beginning of time. He's powerful, and he delivers us, and he loves us, and we are his people. And the kids, wow, that's our God. That's our God. That's who he is to us. It was a teaching for the next generation. And this is important for us to get, because that requirement of God for the believing adults in the community to communicate truth about how God is to the children, it didn't end there with the Israelite nation, but has been God's heart from the beginning. In fact, in Malachi 2:15, God is addressing an issue of adultery within the nation. And God explains that he brought Adam and Eve together for a purpose, and it's that they might stay together and develop godly offspring. That God's heart in marriage and in the family, and we know that there's heartache here because not every person is able to have children, but God's heart from the beginning is that there would be this unit called the family, and there would be a mom and a dad that follow God, and as children are brought into that family, they would be raised as godly offspring. This has been God's heart from the beginning, and the Israelites weren't ignorant of it, and we shouldn't be ignorant of the truth as well, that our lives should instruct our children in the ways of God. Just like the altar was meant to instruct the Israelite children, our very lives as believing parents and believing adults, whether there are children in our home or not, our very lives are these altars or these memorials that are meant to instruct the next generation in the ways of God. And God's been very clear about this from the very beginning. Deuteronomy 6:6-7. As soon as they come out of Egypt, they're gathering and they cross the Red Sea, and there's all this instruction from God given to Moses that's now being downloaded to the people. And here's the instruction. You've heard this. "And these words," speaking of the law, the command, the ways of God, "and these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them," how? "Diligently," to who? Your children. You shall teach the commands and the ways of God diligently to your children. That whole phrase, "you shall teach them diligently," is one Hebrew word that means to sharpen. It means to make able to incise, to cut. It's this idea of being able to pierce through something. For us today, we know the word diligent means that we are constantly pursuing something. We are purposeful about an activity. And when we kind of bring all that in together, what God is teaching us even today as parents and as adults leading the next generation is that there are a group of children who need to be sharpened in the ways of God, and we must be intentional about sharpening them. We must be focused and purposeful about training them up in the ways of God. You shall teach them diligently. This is persistent, focused effort. This isn't something that happens haphazardly. Listen, if you have children, and those of you that are raising them or have them in the past, you know that there are certain things that come naturally, right? Children are self-centered narcissists. And if we don't train them out of that, guess what? They become adults who are self-centered narcissists. That's natural because they are born fallen into sin. It is our responsibility as believers to take them and hone them and guide them purposefully and intentionally into the ways of God so they can be sharpened for his purposes. And because that's not natural, it means that we must then be intentional about what doesn't come easily or naturally to us as parents either. Because we want to be self-focused. We need to be focused on our kids and teaching them. And he gives them some ways to do this. He says, talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. There's this interesting idea put forth that God says, listen, you don't have to be a scholar. You don't have to be a children's minister. You don't have to have it all figured out. You can even be figuring out spiritually your journey with God as well. But what I want you to do is take what you know, and as you have opportunity, which you will, because you're going to wake up and you have all day and you're going to lie down, and throughout that day as you walk, as you go, just talk to your kids about who I am. I want to brag on my wife for a second. She owns the PhD in this, if there was one. She is fantastic with taking the day, and she homeschools our girls, and taking the day and being able to kind of weave in and out the truths of who God is. I'm trying to follow her example, but she's very good. Just yesterday, our children are in Clarksville this weekend. We're trying to wean them a little bit. They're at a youth retreat with a church we're at there, and we're trying to wean them slowly into new life here. And so they wanted to go back to this retreat. And so they're around all these kids and everything. One of our daughters sends a message to mom saying, I kind of feel like our friends have already moved on. Right? They've already kind of forgotten about us. And you know, they're probably feeling some of that. There's some of that separation. But Bridget texted her back and said, you know, I'm sure that you feel that way, and there's probably some of that going on. But you know what? Be focused on others and not on self. And you know, what a great teaching to our children. What I love about that is what we don't feel like we have to sit down and develop this real deep, long Bible study. We just need to be intentional with the moments God gives us to teach our children. So as natural life moves on, hey, here's an open door. We love our daughters. We know it's a difficult move for them, but here's a way to teach them selflessness and servanthood in a very difficult time. How do you love others? How are you focused on others? There was a time when one of our daughters, they were a lot younger, and I don't want to give their names because I don't want to like skew your view of them, but one of them had really smelly feet as a kid, and I remember one day washing one of my daughter's feet. She was three or four, and I put her up on the kitchen sink, or on the bathroom sink, and I start washing her feet, and I'm thinking, teachable moment, okay, how we do this? And I said, you know who else washed somebody's feet? Who else washed somebody's feet? Jesus did, right? So I just say, you know, Jesus taught us to serve people and to love our friends. And I want to wash your feet. One, they stink. And two, I love you. And I want to serve you. Things like that, it's natural. But what it takes is intentionality and focus and purpose. And God said, you're going to build this altar, and it's going to give you an open door to naturally communicate about who I am with your children. They were instructed to constantly teach their kids as they live through life. And we are called to do the same thing as parents. But what if you don't have a child? What if you're single? Listen, if you're an adult and you're a believer, there are children in this church family that need to be taught and instructed. I know it's the same with every church. Every church has problems staffing their nursery and children's areas. Listen, you may never have been trained in that. Kids may scare you, but you can love them. And there's areas right now where you can serve. And maybe that's not for you, but you can pray. You can definitely pray for those who have children, those who are serving, praying diligently that they would see those open doors to communicate. But this is something we must be about. Why? Because every generation, as each generation passes, we are only one generation away from paganism. If we do not instruct the next generation will not follow God. It is on our shoulders. It is a responsibility that we have. We must be purposeful and diligent to step into where we're called to teach and to love those coming after us. All right, the second group here. Now, I want to look down at 24. God mentions kind of two groups, and this is all in the context of teaching something to the children. You're going to remind them of who God is, and there's two other things you're going to instruct them in, but it also talks about two different groups. The next group I want to talk about is the last one that's mentioned. It's the very last phrase there in chapter 4, verse 24. He says that you may fear the Lord your God forever. See, one of the purposes of the altar is not only to help teach the children, but it was to remind the adults of who God is, to help them remember the ways of God themselves. It was meant to remind God's people of God's might. So you can imagine they've crossed the river. They're now in the promised land and they're camped right outside of Jericho. And they're seeing the walls and the city. And maybe they're hearing the stories of the spies that went out 40 years ago. And they said, they're all giants over there. They're going to annihilate us. And it could be possible that within the midst of some hearts, a little bit of fear, a little bit of worry comes up about the people living in Jericho. And then even in the cities beyond that they're called to go in and conquer. And as they would turn around, they would see the altar built there again. And what would that altar do? It would remind them of who God is. It would lead them to fear him and not fear people, as they're reminded of the might and the power of who God is. And that would bring great confidence into their lives as they step forward into more unknown, into more difficulty, into more battles. They would look back and there's the altar. God got us through the Jordan. He stopped. He overcame nature. He stopped the Jordan. We crossed. Okay, he's powerful, he's good, he's with us. Let's move forward now in confidence into more battles and more difficulty. This altar was meant to be a way that they taught their children, but it also existed as a reminder to them of the might of God. And we need to be reminded of that as well, because a lot of us who claim faith in God, we are wimps in our faith. There are a lot of people who claim faith in God, but shudder and melt at difficulty in life as we try to follow God. And we need to be reminded as his people that he's mighty and is powerful. We need to remember what God has done and who he is. When we begin to think and ponder on God and his power and his ability, that fuels us to live in faith. And passages like this give us clear insight into who God is. When we read the story of the nation of Israel crossing over the Jordan, it's clearly communicated to us that God is powerful. How do we know? Well, he stopped the Jordan, right? And we shouldn't doubt this. If you sit here and you struggle with this, well, how? I don't get that that happens. Listen, if you believe that God is creator and that he created natural laws, it would only make sense that we believe he can overrule natural laws, that he can stop things like that when he wants. The God who said to the oceans, this far you shall go and no further, could at any point say, I'm going to let you go further, tsunamis. God controls all of those things. And so a passage like this reminds us of the power and the might of God. And when we go through the Old Testament, we see it. We see creation speaking everything into existence. That's a powerful God who created all things out of nothing for his purposes and his glory. We move on and we see all the people gathered around the Tower of Babel, and God says, you know what? They're all speaking the same language. Poof, different languages. Deal with that now, right? Like, God was able to do that. We move forward and we have the flood where he flooded the entire earth so that even the highest peaks were covered. We see that God can do this. We see the plagues in Egypt. We see the crossing of the Red Sea. We see the crossing of the Jordan. We see all of these things and we see the power and the might of God, but it's real easy for us to step back and say, I've read it, I see it, I believe that he did that, but you know what? My life is a wreck right now. My life is a mess right now. I've trusted him, but I don't see how he's going to get me through. You know what? If he would just do today some of the stuff that he did back in the Old Testament, I'd have a lot of faith. Okay. I get that, right? Like if we're down on the Greenway at the Stones River and he just stopped that creek for a second, that's a small thing. But if he would just do that, thank you, God, I can walk out in faith now, right? Like, we would be encouraged by that. You would say, listen, he doesn't have to close the mouths of lions, but my husband snores a lot. If he could just close that mouth at night, like, I would trust that God is powerful. God, you can do all things. You know, we just ask that he would do something like that. Like, God, you don't have to part the waters, but if when I'm in Walmart and that line's real long, if it could just part and like light come down and angels, oh, you know, I would know that you're leading me. I would have faith. Like, if God would do these physical miracles around me, I would just be encouraged and I would walk with confidence in my life. Can I just put something out there for us this morning? The miracle that God has worked in your heart as a believer far surpasses any physical miracle we read about in the Old Testament. I don't want to belittle those. I don't want to make light of those. They display the enormity of the God that we serve. But physical miracles pale in comparison to spiritual ones. And if you're a believer in Jesus today, you have experienced in your very life the most powerful, profound miracle that has ever occurred on this planet. If you don't believe me, look with me at Ephesians 2. This is one of my favorite passages in Scripture. So as I preach, if as I get opportunity to do so, I apologize. It'll come up often. Ephesians 2, this is talking about you and me. Yeah, Paul's writing to believers in Ephesus, just believers in Murfreesboro as well, okay? And you were what? Dead. You were dead. I was dead. You were dead in the trespasses and sins in which we once walked. Now, some of that terminology we get from Deuteronomy as well, right? As you walk, as you live, teach about God's children. Well, Paul is saying, as you walk, as you live, you were dead in this life. In which you once walked, your following sins and trespasses, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work, and the sons of disobedience. You know who that's talking about? Satan, right? So Paul is saying, you're believers now, you're in the church in Ephesus, but there was a day when you were dead in your sin, and guess who you were following, whether you knew it or not? You're a follower of Satan. You're in his dominion. He was controlling your life. We don't need to lose that. Before we come to know who Jesus is, we are dead followers of Satan and his way. That just makes the miracle. You might say, well, I'm a good person. No, you're not. No, no. Okay, let's keep going. The spirit that is not working, sons of disobedience. Verse 3, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh. So not only were we following Satan and his ways, but we loved it. Carrying out the desires of the body and the mind. And we're by nature, by birth, children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. All the people we judge and put down, we're just like them. But this is, and I'm a youth minister, and I always wanted to say this, but I know I would lose the crowd here. You guys are much more mature than any students I've ever worked with. This is the biggest butt in the Bible right here, okay? Verse 4. You're mature. No one laughed at that. You may have giggled. Wives nudge their husbands. Don't you laugh at that. This is a huge turn, a massive turn in Scripture, because Paul has just said, basically, you're Satan worshipers because you're worshiping your flesh. Whether you know it or not, you're dead, you're fallen, and you're lost without hope. But who? God. But God being rich, overflowing, abundant in mercy because of the great love which with he loved me and with which he loved you, even when we were what? Dead. Okay, audience participation. Dead in our sin, our trespasses. He made us what? Alive. Even when we were dead in our sin, God made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And he raised us up with him and he seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. We're going to come back to that in a second. That's an amazing truth. So that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. So we've gone from being children of wrath to now recipients of the unending kindness of God. Verse 8, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and none of this is of your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of work, so you can't be good enough, so that no one may boast. Verse 10, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand, that we should walk in him. I want us to remember the mighty work of God in our lives as followers of Jesus. Because when life gets hard and difficult as believers, our temptation will be to doubt his ability. But there is no greater truth of the ability of God than our salvation. When we look at these verses, we see a few things. We see one, that God has taken us out of the dominion of Satan and he has adopted us into his family. That is something we could not do on our own, but in God's great grace and his love, he looked at us dead in sin. I'm going to take you and I'm going to bring you into my family. What an amazing transition. God brought us out of death and he gave us life. But life in who? And with who? Jesus. There's an amazing truth in this passage that's communicating that our position right now before God, even though we're still living on this earth, our position before God is as co-heirs and equals with the Son of God, Jesus Christ. Did you know that although your practice in life might not line up to it, your position in life is as a co-heir with Christ? And as God looks down on me and you as his followers, he sees someone just as righteous as his Son. Soak on that. That doesn't sound right. It feels weird, but it's true. Why? Because as believers, what have we been given? The righteousness of who? Jesus. Okay, so God's done that, which means then that we have been transformed from workers of lawlessness, slaves of lawlessness, now into workers of righteousness. We had no way to help ourselves. We loved sin. We loved ourselves. We served ourselves. We were dead in sin. By nature, we were facing the wrath of God, but God stepped in and through Jesus Christ has granted us forgiveness, life, and purpose now to be workers of righteousness. And the beauty of this is we didn't do anything to deserve it, to earn it, to cause it to occur. Jesus did all of this. Jesus lived the life we could not live. He lived in complete harmony with the commands of God. Jesus died the death that we should have died on the cross. He was punished. He received the wrath that we were due. And then Jesus defeated death so that we might live now and forever. Jesus has done this for us. So for those of us as believers who are following Christ that struggle with the weight of life, I'm scared. I know he has delivered me. I know I have salvation, but I don't see how he's going to handle this problem in my family or with work or with finances. Things are crumbling. God, I don't see where you are. How are you going to do this? Listen, if we can trust God for our eternity, we can trust him in the here and now. If we can go to sleep tonight saying, God, I know if I die tonight, I'll wake with you in glory. I trust that and I can lay my head down and sleep peacefully. We can trust him with the day to day. No matter how difficult it is, he's got it. And your life, your saved life should be a reminder to you of the power, the faithfulness, the might, and the ability of the God who brought you from death and gave you life. Just as that altar reminded the Israelites as they moved into unknown territory and dangerous battles, as it brought a confidence to them that God would deliver, our salvation should do the same for us. Now this leads us into the final group, and it's important that that's why I wanted to look at this last group next, because it leads us into this third group that the altar is communicating about. Look back with me. Let's just read verse 21 to 24 again. And he said to the people of Israel, when your children ask their fathers in times to come, what do these stones mean? Then you shall let your children know, Israel passed over this Jordan on dry ground. For the Lord your God dried up the waters of the Jordan for you until you passed over, as the Lord your God did to the Red Sea, which he dried up for us until we passed over. Why? Verse 24. So that all the peoples of the what? Earth. So we've dealt with children in Israel. We've dealt with God's people. Now we're dealing with everyone else, all right? We're just putting everybody that lives on the earth. Okay, it's talking about all them, everyone. So that all the peoples of the earth may know that the hand of the Lord is mighty. So this altar existed so they could teach their children. It existed so they could be reminded as followers of God, he's got this. And it existed as a testimony of God's power to all people, so that when the enemies peering over the wall in Jericho into Gilgal, where these 2 million Israelites were encamped, they had seen the water stop and then they had seen it flow again, but they would see that altar of the stones that they could never reach before because the Jordan covered them. They would now see those stones brought out of the Jordan, built on dry ground, and it would be a reminder, hey, the God of Israel, guess what? He's stout, right? He's powerful. He is mighty. They weren't even part of the Israelite people, but they knew the God of Israel. They knew his ability. They saw the altar, and it meant to be a communication and a testimony to them that the God of Israel was an awesome God. Now, don't tell Sherman, but I'm going to read a little bit of chapter 5, okay? This is his for next week, so we'll just keep it between us. But look at verse 1 with me. As soon as all the kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan to the west, and all the kings of the Canaanites who were beyond the sea, heard that the Lord had dried up the waters of the Jordan for the people of Israel until they crossed over, their hearts melted, and there was no longer any spirit in them because of the people of Israel. See, whether they saw the altar, they knew what God had done. The truth of who God is was being communicated. And God's enemies and the enemies of the people were hearing about it. And guess what happened? Their hearts were melted. And it says their spirits within them left them. They were just like puddles of goo, right? We can't stand before this God. Did you see what he did? They're going to annihilate us. They're going to wipe us out. Their God is the true God. We have no confidence in our own ability to stand up before him. He is the one true God. He's mighty. This is what the enemies of God are communicating. And so this altar was part of that process of saying to all people that the God of Israel is awesome, that he is the God of all creation. And this altar stood as a symbol of God's power over his enemies. And here's the last thing I want us to get then as we think then into our lives. See, our lives, just as that altar was a symbol to God's enemies of his power, our saved lives that we just talked about out of Ephesians 2 are living altars that God will use to melt the hearts of the lost. What God has done in your life by saving you, he has created you into a memorial of his power and his ability. Your life lived out daily in faith and obedience as you go into the difficulties, as you go into the workplaces and schools and marketplaces of our city. Guess what? You're a walking, living, breathing memorial and monument to the life-changing power of God. And it is by God's design that he uses our lives to melt the hearts of the lost and prepare them for salvation. Let me share with you 2 Corinthians 5, verses 17 to 21. It says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation, right? Old is gone, death is done away with, by nature, children of wrath, removed, no longer serving Satan, all of that removed, we've been made now a new creation. The old has passed away, behold, the new has come. Okay, so this is us. Verse 18, and all this is from God, right? We talked about Jesus did all of this, who through Christ reconciled us to himself. So that word reconciled, it's a banking term that means to balance out, right? So it means that what the bank says you have, your checkbook says you have, or if they say you have a debt, you pay the debt and you become even. That's what it means to reconcile. So God, we had a debt to him through Jesus. He made us at peace with God. He reconciled us. And then look what he did. In verse 18, the middle of that, he says, and then he gave us the ministry of reconciliation. So we've been given work to do. The end of Ephesians chapter 2 said that we are created for good works that God created beforehand, that we should walk in them. Once we become believers, our mission doesn't end, right? We now have a purpose to live out, and it's for our lives to be used as ministers of reconciliation. I've always thought that, God, wouldn't it be easier if you just like took bananas and on the inside of the pills, it just said Jesus is Messiah, and as people all around the world are eating bananas, like, it's got to be true. It's on the inside of the banana, right? Like God could do anything to communicate the truth of who he is, but what did he do? He saved people who were lost. He saved people who were dead in sin. And now he said, guess what? You're going to communicate this to the rest of the world. It continues on. So in Christ, verse 18, all this is from God who through Christ reconciled us to himself, gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, and here's the ministry, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself. He has a heart that all peoples will come to know him, not counting their trespasses against them and entrusting to us the message. So there's something that has to be spoken and communicated, the message of how to be reconciled to God. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. That altar was an ambassador for the power and the might of God. It spoke of who he was. We are now ambassadors for Christ. God makes his appeal through bananas? No. through us. God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him, Jesus, to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Our lives are living altars that God uses to melt the hearts of those who don't trust in him yet. As they see us living in faith and in obedience each day, living lives of grace and forgiveness and patience and mercy, lives that used to look one way, but now because of God look completely different, and it's confusing our friends and our families and our neighbors. As they see that, they know something has changed. God has done something in your life, and as you have the opportunity to live that out and to speak it, as God makes his appeal through you, he begins to melt hearts. Well, if God did that in his life, can he do that in mine? Well, if God was able to overcome this in him, can he overcome that in me? Well, if God was able to make this person happy and joyous, I want to be happy and joyous. Maybe he can do that in me. See, our lives are that living altar that God will use to draw people to himself. We carry a mighty burden and a great responsibility as the people of God. And it begins with our children, and it extends to our neighbors. And as these two young ladies are up here this morning, and as we have men that are out today, it extends around the world. We have a burden and a responsibility to live as the altars of God and to be the ambassadors of God so that he might make his appeal through us.